IPMNation.com.
Thanks, Wolf. Always great to be with you.
Thanks so much for joining us. And I want to start by playing a little of what you've told me on the question of President Trump and collusion. Listen to this.
Is there any doubt in my mind that he colluded with Russia? I don't know. Do George and Kellyanne sleep in the same bed? No. Wolf, the answer is no. There's no doubt. It's Mueller time, motherfucker. Lock him up. Lock him up.
Impeach!
So as you know, according to the special counsel, Robert Mueller, the investigation did not establish that members of the Trump campaign conspired or coordinated with the Russian government. Are you ready to accept that conclusion from Robert Mueller?
100%, Wolf. This is only good news for the country. And I am here today to say that I am ready to leave this behind us and move on without some big song and dance. Excuse me.
OMG, he's reached a conclusion. Holy sh! I'm sorry to curse, bitch. Thankfully, there's been no collusion. So why don't I feel better yet? In fact, I feel worse.
The Mueller report now turned in. Robert Mueller's work is over.
It's lasted 22 months. It's no wonder we're stressed. Wish we could just let it go. The things that we learned are not what we guessed. And as for the rest, we may never know.
How much, if anything, will America get to see?
I've got those. Yay, it's finally over. Wait, it's only just beginning. Blues. Those damn you, Robert Mueller. I mean, thank you for your service. Feelings. Those, give me that report. Now throw this trash in the bin. Congratulations, Hannity. But wait, what'd you win? Those, what about obstruction? Here comes Rudy Giuliani. Feelings. Those, isn't really over. Can we still indict Ivanka? Blues.
Robert Mueller has delivered his report, but the political fight over it is just beginning.
Repeatedly, he stated,
no collusion.
He said, I guess that he was right.
Are there any Russians here tonight?
Is he exonerated?
Total exoneration.
Technically, not quite.
Mueller stopping short of exonerating the president.
His comments were off color.
And we kicked their ass.
He'd constantly deny.
No collusion.
No collusion.
No collusion. No collusion.
And slander Mr. Mueller.
But the entire thing has been a witch hunt.
Now look who's his favorite guy. He's got those. Maybe if I hadn't been so shady in the first place. Blues.
Russia, if you're listening.
Those LOL, I told you so. Oh God, that was a close one. Feelings. Those, I'm so smart, I knew it was a hoax and a hunt. Now I'll play the victim till I get what I want. That I should be more honest, but it's not what Daddy taught me. Feelings. Those, no, I haven't read it. Time for celebrations. How is it your business what I do with foreign nations? Hope they just forget those other 12 investigations. Blues.
Well, 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 look at you with no convictions. I tell you, it's a great day to be an American. I mean, Donald Trump, Jussie Smollett, you in that pink blouse, people are getting away with murder around here. Sarah, will we ever see the full report?
I think that the president is doing exactly what he should, and that's leaving that decision into the hands of the attorney general.
Well, is it wrong for the president to claim this is a total exoneration when the attorney general's letter clearly says it's not?
It is. It is a complete and total exoneration, and here's why.
You are really feeling yourself today.
Because the special counsel, they said they couldn't make a decision one way or the other. The way the process works is then they leave that up to the attorney general.
Nancy, go and get them. Never mind, girl, I'm exhausted. Blues.
Mueller blues.
Those, what the hell is Comey doing standing in a forest?
Feelings.
Those, bartender, we're gonna need to refill my cup. And since there's no collusion, could you make something up? And why does Devin's cow have way more followers than I do? Feelings. Those, is it over? What just happened? Can't we just arrest Ivanka? Where's the rest? I gotta see it. Give it to me. I don't want it. Yes, no. Black, white, red, blue, left, right. Thank you. Go away now. Please don't leave me, Robert Mueller.
Major victory for President Trump investigation.
No collusion.
Impeach!
You know, listen to somebody. You know, I'm not just saying Lenny Bruce or something. And, you know, get a better routine.
if I ever got impeached, I think everybody would be very poor.
Hello, everybody. It's that time again. Matt Connerton unleashed. We are live on WMNH 95.3 FM, emanating from kind of really the, for the second day in a row, kind of a dreary, rainy downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Actually, I think yesterday was just dreary, but not raining. Today it's kind of raining, kind of just dreary, just kind of bleh. We got spoiled by, we had like 5 days in a row of sun. Can't even believe it. Anyway, so we are live on WMNH 95.3. And, of course, Comcast 97, if you're in Manchester, streaming worldwide at WMNHradio.org and on Facebook via Facebook Live on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. Today is Wednesday, May 29th, 2019. 603-250-6007 is the number to call. 603-250-6007. Oh, whatever shall we discuss today? Let's see. We do have a bunch of folks in the Facebook live chat already, which is, of course, another way that you can interact with the program if you don't feel like calling. Hello to Steve Pascucci in the Facebook live chat. I see Christian Cunard. She says, hi, Matt. Steve says, good afternoon, Mr. Connerton. Oh, no. Mr. Connerton, that's my dad. You can just call me Matt or Maddie or Matthew or Matthias. Hello to Jesse Ape. How do you say your last name? Well, it doesn't matter because that's Ape the Grim. We'll just call him Ape the Grim. He was on the show recently. Let's see. Oh, wow. We got a lot of people. Hello to Ed Murphy in the Facebook live chat, who had commented on Facebook a few minutes ago that he was hoping I could wait till the second hour of the show to talk about Robert Mueller's statement today. And I said, I don't think I have that kind of discipline. I don't think I can hold out. But there you are, Ed, in the Facebook live chat. Nice to see you in there. Hello to Lauren DeLuca in the Facebook live chat. Hello, Lauren. And Wayne Noel joins us in there as well. Hi, Wayne. Ed says, jump right in to the report. I'm with you. Very good, Ed Murphy. I'm glad you're able to be here so soon. You deserve an air horn. All right. Well, what I think we should do is, yes, this came as a surprise, by the way, to me. I don't know if it was a surprise to anyone else or if everybody else knew and I just missed something, but I didn't realize until I heard it mentioned this morning that early this morning that Robert Mueller was going to be giving a statement at 11 a.m. today. And I was aghast. I didn't see this coming. I didn't know he was going to be doing this. And I was a quiver with excitement. So because I get excited about these kinds of things, what I'd like to do is I will, for those of you who did not hear it, if you haven't heard it or watched it, I'm going to play it for you. I'm going to play the whole thing. It's only about 10 minutes long, but it'll probably take longer than 10 minutes because I know that there's a couple of points, at least two or three points here where I'm going to just interject with some thoughts that I think are important. Plus, let's be honest, I also don't have the discipline to just play this without commenting. Two ads at the beginning of the video. Getting a little greedy there, aren't we, YouTube? If you notice that recently, they used to give you one ad. Now they give you two. I mean, still, you just click the skip ads. But come on! All right, so that's 11 minutes and 16 seconds. Well, this is from CNN, so I think there's some extra stuff at the end where Jake Tapper and somebody else talks or something. But here, so I'm going to play this. Like I said, I had no idea this was going to be happening today, but the he is officially resigned from the Department of Justice, and he has closed this investigation officially. I thought it was already closed officially, but apparently it's like double official now. So let's give this a listen. Robert Mueller, we've rarely heard his voice in public. You know, we did hear him, of course, when he way back almost two decades ago now when he, I'm not a big fan of Robert Mueller. It has nothing to do with the Russia probe, of course. I'm not a big fan because he was part of the team of liars who helped sell the Iraq war on the American people when he was running the FBI, and he testified in front of Congress and, oh, yeah, yeah, I gotta go in. They've got weapons of mass destruction. Yes, Robert Mueller was, people forget that he was part of that, but he didn't have as large a part of that as someone like, George Tenet, who was running the CIA at the time, who said, it's a slam dunk. And, they've got yellow cake or something, and they're building nukes and they're going to kill all of us. We got to invade now. I mean, I'm being a bit hyperbolic with it. He didn't literally say all that, but he pretty much said all that. Robert Mueller, I think, might have been a bit more restrained, as seems to be his normal demeanor, a bit more somber. But anyway, all right, so this is, now that I've reminded everyone that I don't really like the guy, or anyone connected to the W administration who helped facilitate our invasion of Iraq. Little disclaimer there. I just don't want anyone thinking, oh, you know, Matt doesn't like Trump. He was investigating Trump's, so he must love Mueller. You got to remember, you know, I'm not as liberal as everyone thinks I am, and I'm an independent. I'm not a Democrat. Just because I dump on Trump all the time doesn't mean I'm a Democrat, okay? At the end, I really just, I think that to ascend to this level of government, be it the presidency or head of the FBI or whatever it may be, or the CIA, you probably have to have some level of sociopathy. I don't trust any of these people reflexively, to be honest with you. Anyway, okay, here it is.
2 years ago, the acting attorney general asked me to serve as special counsel, and he created the special counsel's office. The appointment order directed the office to investigate Russian interference in the 2016 presidential election. This included investigating any links or coordination between the Russian government and individuals associated with the Trump campaign.
Now, I have individual one, for example, who's also the president. Individual one. That's what I think of when I hear that word individual or individuals. I think of individual one, our commander in chief. Sorry, I don't mean to.
I have not spoken publicly during our investigation. I'm speaking out today because our investigation is complete. The attorney general has made the report on our investigation largely public. We are formally closing the special counsel's office, and as well, I'm resigning from the Department of Justice to return to private life. I'll make a few remarks about the results of our work. But beyond these few remarks, it is important that the office's written work speak for itself. Let me begin where the appointment order begins, and that is interference in the 2016 presidential election. As alleged by the grand jury in an indictment, Russian intelligence officers who were part of the Russian military launched a concerted attack on our political system. The indictment alleges that they used sophisticated cyber techniques to hack into computers and networks used by the Clinton campaign.
Here, we'll take a quick break because we have a call. Let's grab this. I was thinking that could be Robert Mueller now that he's got some time on his hands. Maybe he was calling into the show. Never mind.
They stole private information and then released that information through fake online and identities and through the organization WikiLeaks. The releases were designed and timed to interfere with our election and to damage a presidential candidate. And at the same time, as the grand jury alleged in a separate indictment, a private Russian entity engaged in a social media operation where Russian citizens posed as Americans in order to influence an election. These indictments contain allegations, and we are not commenting on the guilt or the innocence of any specific defendant. Every defendant is presumed innocent unless and until proven guilty. The indictments allege and the other activities in our report describe efforts to interfere in our political system They needed to be investigated and understood, and that is among the reasons why the Department of Justice established our office. That is also a reason we investigated efforts to obstruct the investigation. The matters we investigated were of paramount importance. It was critical for us to obtain full and accurate information from every person we questioned. When a subject of an investigation obstructs that investigation or lies to investigators, it strikes at the core of their government's effort to find the truth and hold wrongdoers accountable. Let me say a word about the report. The report has two parts, addressing the two main issues we were asked to investigate. The first volume of the report details numerous efforts emanating from Russia to influence the election. This volume includes a discussion of the Trump campaign's response to this activity, as well as our conclusion that there was insufficient evidence to charge a broader conspiracy. And in the second volume, the report describes the results and analysis of our obstruction of justice investigation involving the president. The order appointing me special counsel authorized us to investigate actions that could obstruct the investigation. And we conducted that investigation, and we kept the office of the acting attorney general apprised of the progress of our work. And as set forth in the report, after that investigation, if we had had confidence that the president clearly did not commit a crime, we would have said so. We did not, however, make a determination as to whether the president did commit a crime.
I want to stop. Okay, that's one of the things I wanted to stop on. I don't mean to interrupt, but this is important. He said, if we had high confidence that the president did not commit a crime, we would have said so. Remember, and by the way, to be fair, William Barr, in his initial presentation, you know, where he kind of tried to, you know, he's Trump's guy. I don't care what anyone says. William Barr, when he, you know, in his initial presentation, basically, you know, where he tried to say, okay, nothing to see here. We're all good. Okay, thanks. Bye. He did say, I mean, I'm sort of being a little funny about it. In all fairness, he did say in his initial summation of Mueller's report that Mueller and his team did say in the report they could not exonerate the president on obstruction of justice. That is not drastically different from what Mueller is saying here, in my opinion. And as I say all this, I mean, obviously, I'm speaking as a layman. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a legal expert of any kind. So just, you know, it's just my opinion. And obviously, if you're a MAGA person, you'll just naturally see this very differently, I'm sure. It's very important, that statement, and we'll talk about it more later, but it's very important when he says, if we thought, how did he put it exactly? I might back it up a little bit. If we thought we could exonerate the president, or if we had high confidence that the president had done nothing illegal, we would have said so. So in other words, yeah, Barr kind of said Mueller has said in the report he could not exonerate the president, but Mueller's kind of putting a finer point on it, kind of driving that point home. We could not exonerate him on obstruction. And then later gets into the other part of that, which is, because here's the thing. If you can't exonerate someone, if you have all this evidence that someone did something, and in the report, depending on whose count you want to go by, there's 9 or 10 or 11 different instances where Trump appears to have obstructed justice. I mean, I think the Don McGahn one is the most glaring example, where he told Don McGahn, basically told Don McGahn, fire Mueller, and then told Don McGahn to falsify a document saying that that conversation never happened between Trump and McGahn about firing Mueller. You know, I mean, again, I'm not a legal expert, but that sure sounds like obstruction of justice to me. You know, and there's a number of other examples. But there's the other part of it is, so you have evidence. So if you have evidence and you can't exonerate someone, one would indict, right? I didn't mean for that to rhyme. But I do it all the time. I'm kidding. Maybe this is a good time to take this call before I slip into my alter ego, M. Sizzle, start busting out some rhymes. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
It's your old pal, Fred.
Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple. How are you, sir? Hey, I opened with that John Prine song that you had sent me. I don't know if you were listening.
Nice, huh?
Yeah,
thank you.
That is a great song. What's
here's an interesting thought about what he was saying.
Yes.
He starts off with, we didn't try to, it was never our intention. We knew from day one we were not going to indict anyone or indict the president.
Right.
We knew that. We knew we couldn't legally even do it, so we didn't even go into it looking to do that.
Right.
So that's why when he says, but if we found that there was no crime, we would have said there was no crime. But I'm not,
right.
He's trying to tell you right up front, I'm not allowed to say there was a crime. He's not allowed to say there was a crime.
Right.
Because you can't indict him. You just said that, right? I mean, that's the whole reason.
Right, exactly, yeah.
So that's as much as any person could say of, yeah, he did it. I mean, we're just telling you, we weren't allowed to say that he did it.
Right.
But we're also not able to tell you, but we could if we would.
Right.
If we were able, we certainly would be able to tell you that he hadn't done it.
Right.
But we can't tell you that he did do it because of the hour-long conversation I had right before that about, you know, that we're not legally allowed to say that.
Right. Well, he gets into that, too, later in the statement when he talks about when he talks about how, you know, it's Justice Department policy. Because I know that it's on their website and everything, and I had read some things and seen some clips of people kind of arguing over whether or not, because it's kind of a weird thing if you think about it, because what if I'm talking about the, you know, that you can't actually,
right.
let me ask you this, Fred. He says later, and we didn't get to that part yet in the clip, but I want to ask you this. He says, Mueller himself says it's actually constitutionally you can't do it. And that's why that it's not just a Justice Department policy.
No,
he says constitutionally,
I believe what he said was you can't. It's not that he can't constitutionally do it because, I mean, you can't charge a man who can't defend himself. But because of the policy, he says there's another remedy in the Constitution.
Oh, is that what he says?
And that remedy is to get, you know, since we can't do it, the Constitution came up with their own remedy.
Oh, is that? Okay.
And that is to have the Congress do it.
Oh, I gotcha.
That's called impeachment, and that's what he was referring to.
Okay.
The remedy is, you know, I can't do it because of the Justice Department, but the Constitution gave us the answer to that.
Okay.
It says you'd have to take, and that's why it has nothing to do with Bill Barr. He doesn't get to say yes or no.
Right.
He doesn't get to say yes or no with the president. Anybody else, yeah.
Yeah.
But he can't do it for the president because the president, you know, can't be indicted. So how can he do it?
Right, right.
By his own rules. So it has to go to the Congress. That's what he came out and told people today.
Yeah.
And he said, yes, you should go do that because I sent you a bunch of evidence.
Right.
That's what he was saying.
Right.
I mean, you see, I like to show people now when I'm trolling, I take the pictures of the three pages that are redacted that go through, you know, 1 through 14 of the ongoing investigations.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you go, you know, whenever they say, you know, no clue, you know, I just go, can anybody tell us what's behind door number 1 through 14?
Right.
Well, there you go. I'll let you get back to your show, but I just thought that you just wanted to, so you understand. He was saying he couldn't do it, but there is a remedy, and that's the remedy you should take, and it's the constitutional one, getting Congress to do the impeachment and the investigation.
Right, right. Okay. All right.
Well, all right.
Well, thank you, Fred.
Talk to you later, boss.
All right, my friend. Bye-bye. All right, Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple. Oh, Ed Murphy made a comment in the Facebook live chat. He says, I love how he ends that. Basically, he won't say anything else ever. We need popcorn for this. Oh, yeah. Ed's talking about we haven't gotten to it yet right now, but what Robert Mueller says at the end, where he basically says, this is the last time. Or maybe did he already say it earlier in the statement? I think he says it again at the end. He says, I won't speak of this again. Oh, hello to Fred in the Facebook live chat as well. Let's see. Oh, Wayne Noel in the Facebook live chat says, getting ready to stir up the five. Wait. Oh, getting ready to stir up the S, are you? Always, Wayne. You can swear in the Facebook live chat. I just can't swear on the show. Oh, and Ed also said, can't wait to hear the White House response. And then, of course, the late night post-Scotch presidential tweets. Oh, I don't know about that, Ed. I don't think that's quite fair. Unless you don't believe President. And I don't know why you wouldn't believe President Trump when he says this. But
I've never had alcohol.
He says he's never had alcohol. So I don't know.
It's one of my only good traits.
Yes.
I don't drink.
He claims he doesn't drink. He's straight edge. He wouldn't use that term. He wouldn't know what it means. But hello to Jenny in the Facebook live chat. Angia is in there as well. Hello. All right. Let's resume this Robert Mueller statement today. Actually, I'm going to back it up just a little bit because I want to hear that part again where he says we could not exonerate the president.
His response to this activity, as well as our conclusion that there was insufficient evidence to charge a broader conspiracy. And in the second volume, the report describes the results and analysis of our obstruction of justice investigation involving the president. The order appointing me special counsel authorized us to investigate actions that could obstruct the investigation. And we conducted that investigation, and we kept the Office of the Acting Attorney General apprised of the progress of our work. And as set forth in the report, after that investigation, if we had had confidence that the president clearly did not commit a crime, we would have said so. We did not, however, make a determination as to whether the president did commit a crime. The introduction to the Volume 2 of our report explains that decision. It explains that under long-standing department policy, a president cannot be charged with a federal crime while he is in office. That is unconstitutional. Even if the charge is kept under seal and hidden from public view, that too is prohibited.
That part right there is also really important, and that's one of the things I wanted to key in on just for a second, because there had been this open question about, is it possible that there would be a sealed indictment of Trump that we were not allowed to know about? And the reason being, so if I understand the legal theory correctly, if you can't indict a sitting president and let's say Trump wins re-election, and then by winning re-election, that adds another 4 years that he can't be indicted for anything. And he sort of runs out the clock in terms of a statute of limitations. And if so, what could happen is there could be a sealed indictment, a secret indictment, effectively, that, you know, the public isn't allowed to know about, but that actually stops when you do a sealed indictment, I guess. And I didn't know about any of this prior to all of this. Again, I'm not a legal expert, but if I understand this correctly, a sealed indictment would effectively stop the clock on the statute of limitations. So then he could be indicted after he left office because the statute of limitations wouldn't matter at that point if it were a sealed indictment. That was one of the theories that might have happened. And it's a pretty tantalizing theory, you know, to think that maybe that's what was really going on and we just weren't allowed to know about it because it is a sealed indictment. But Mueller, in this statement, kind of puts that, well, not kind of, he puts that to rest. And no sealed indictment, because you can't do that either to a sitting president, according to what Mueller is saying here. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, it's Scumpy. How are you, man?
Jeff Scumpy Lorenz. How are you, sir?
I'm pretty good, actually.
Well, good. You sound good.
Yes, I'm thinking, you're saying if he gets reelected, he will get reelected.
You have high confidence that he will be reelected.
I really do. What do you think? What's the odds reelected? I would bet you $100 right now he gets reelected.
Well, I'm not a betting man, Scumpy, but I've been saying for a long time, this is what I think. If the economy holds, and it's still chugging along pretty well, if the economy holds...
Wicked.
Yeah,
if
the economy holds, I think he has an excellent chance of winning re-election. If the economy doesn't, if it starts to slow down drastically, then I think he's got a problem. I think even extremely popular presidents and Trump's approval rating overall is very low. I mean, with Republicans, it's like 90%, but overall it's very low. But even if you have, you know, I always think back to 1992, or actually it was 91 when this happened. So you had George H.W. Bush, who had a 90% approval rating across the board after the first Gulf War. Then the economy fell off a cliff, and so did his approval rating. So I think the economy trumps, no pun intended, I promise, I think the economy trumps everything else. If the economy is strong, I think he'll cruise to re-election easily. I always say all he has to do is convince everybody who voted for him the first time to vote for him again, and you all will.
No, they will. They will. Yes. They will, and more. Because people are making money. There's more jobs. The country is actually in great shape right now. Great shape.
Fred in the Facebook.
And, you know, and a lot of times, what happens is like you said, Bush. You know, yeah, Clinton. When Clinton was a president, Democrat. I was a Democrat back then. I mean, I liked Democrats back then. When Clinton was there, I was doing well. I was doing very, very well.
Times were great.
So I loved Clinton because I did very well.
So does Mike Doyle, you by know? The way. Interestingly
the
enough,
changes yeah. it goes. Back, that's why I'm an independent. I am not a Democrat or a Republican. I'm an independent.
Yeah.
But I love what Trump's doing.
Fred in the Facebook live chat thinks I should take the
bet. There's jobs everywhere. You can go on Monster or whatever, any of those job searches. Man, there's a million jobs where anybody who wants to work can work right now.
There's actually too many jobs in this state. We have a labor crisis here. But
and when did that happen?
Well, it's been a slow build, but yeah, I mean, there's a lot of businesses right now that can't even find enough help, especially in the restaurant sector and the food sector.
A lot of businesses too. You know, what's going down the tubes is all these millennials. They're all computer guys. You know, phone and technology stuff. The regular trades, building buildings, ironwork, all that kind of the trades. You know, working making parts in a steel place. You know what I mean? It's crazy. No kids want to do it anymore. They all want to do video type. They all want to stay home and work at home. And yeah, it's crazy.
Well, there is actually it's interesting that you mentioned that, because I was talking to somebody recently too who said that the you know, and you see locally here, we've got a lot of construction going on, but that's also, I don't know if this is nationally or just around here, if it's isolated, but in the construction sector too, they're also having a really hard time right now finding enough help. There's a real shortage of labor.
The machine shop guys, there's no one doing that anymore. There's all the millennial people, they want to do computer jobs, and someone's going to have to go out and build this stuff.
Right.
Whether it's piping or plumbing or, you know, ironwork, or, you know, someone has to go out and do this, and these kids aren't, they don't want to do it, and everybody in that sector is gone. It's awful.
Fred thinks I should take the bet. He doesn't believe that Trump will win re-election.
Who wants to bet me?
I don't know if he wants to bet. I don't know if he wants to bet you. He's telling me to take the bet. I'm not a betting.
We can't do this. We can't do this on air, man. It'd be illegal, wouldn't it?
Probably. No, I'm not. You know, I can't bet you anyway because I think you're right.
He will be reelected. There's so many, all the blue collar workers. They all love him. They're all making money. There's jobs up the yin. He's bringing jobs up. They're building a new plant in Detroit.
I think he has a vulnerability, though. He's got to figure. He's killing the farming sector with these tariffs, this trade war.
Yeah, but he'll figure that out too.
He better hurry up because farm bankruptcies in the Midwest have skyrocketed. He better figure that out quick. This trade war was a terrible idea. He doesn't know what he's doing.
But he's throwing them all kinds of money to keep them alive.
Yeah.
Just waiting for good
weather. And who's right. And who's paying for that, Scumpy? We are. We have to bail out with our tax dollars. We now have to bail out the very farmers who didn't have to suffer in the first place. Why do this? Why do this to begin with?
I don't know. No, we bail out everybody. It's better us bailing them out than it is all the corporate shit. All the corporations grabbing money from all our money and using it for their own pleasure. You can't do that. And that's what's wrong with it. I don't know. I'm upset.
You're upset about corporate welfare, or you're upset about corporations not paying taxes? Well, the corporate, that's why
everyone hates Trump, because, you know, he had so much money, he came in. It's all the corporate leaders that ruled all the money, and they were making all the money, and, like, they're all getting rich. And we're paying more taxes, we're paying more everything. The jobs are going to China, they're going everywhere. And Trump went in and said, you know what, let's bring America back, and America's back. Look at all the jobs coming into the country now. The unemployment is lower than it ever has been. It's crazy. I don't know why anyone can really be, you know, even if you hate Trump, you got to at least respect your president and what he's doing.
Well,
he's done everything he said he was going to do.
I'm pretty reticent to give too much credit and or blame to the chief executive for how the economy is doing. I don't people like that sort of that Hopwood calls it the I forget where it comes from originally. He calls it the big man theory, that the president's, you know, sitting at the Oval Office and sitting at his desk in the Oval Office, pulling the various levers controlling the economy. And I think it's far more complicated than that. But he's killing the farming sector.
We really don't know what's going on. You know, we really don't. The average person in this country doesn't really know what exactly is going on, but.
Yeah, so
I'm liking what I see. I really liking what I see.
Well, I wanted to give him credit on some foreign policy things, but you know, he said we were going to get out of Syria. I don't know what happened to that. I'm very concerned about that. I thought we were going to draw down in Afghanistan. That seems to be out the window. I don't know what's happening with North Korea now. He seems to think everything's rosy, but he's literally the only one. So I don't know about him doing everything he said he was going to do. I think he's flailing all over the place.
Remember when we were kids, I don't know how old you are, Matt, exactly, but remember everything you bought said made in Taiwan, made in Taiwan, made in Taiwan.
Sure.
When did it change over and all of a sudden it's made in China, made in China, made in China? Everything's made in China and all the corporations went over there because they could pay these people pennies to... You have to bring it back to the country, and we'll make it here. Look at Detroit. Detroit is, like, just gone. It's a wasteland. It's a wasteland. Look at Japan. We blew them up with an atom bomb in the 40s, and it's unbelievable. You look at their city and look at Detroit. What happened there? What happened?
And Trump, when he went to Japan, he wished them a happy Memorial Day, which was very nice. By the way, Scumpy, yeah. Pandora in the Facebook live chat says, I disagree. Not all young people want to be computer workers. A lot don't. But when they want to work in the food business, they get turned down. Oh, that's interesting.
Well, the food business is huge. I mean, if you want to work in the food business, I think if you work on, like, these cruise ships, I know a girl that does.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard work, and you work constantly.
Mm-hmm.
These cruise ships,
oh, yeah.
You make a ton of money, but, boy, you work your ass off.
Yeah, it's not glamorous.
Most of them can't handle the amount of work, you know, 100 hours, 80 hours a week just cooking and cooking and cooking.
Right, right.
You know, but.
Yeah.
And it's not like being a chef. Okay, get hired as a chef at a good restaurant. Oh, you know, nice. Okay, I'm the head chef. This is what I want to make. I'm going to, you know, put it up a notch. But
this conversation's making me hungry.
I worked in the food business, and it sucked. I mean, well, it was nice, but it kind of sucked. I didn't make any money.
Well, what was nice about it if it sucked?
No. You know what was nice about it is, like, when people would come in and they'd want something special, and they'd say, I want Scumpy to cook my food.
Oh.
I'd make them something real special. Oh. Wasn't on the menu.
Oh.
You know, they say, I want a fettuccine seafood Alfredo with some broccoli. Okay.
Some fettuccine Al Scumpy.
Of shrimp under there and a couple of scallops. You give them a huge meal, they come back every time.
Put a little Scumpy on it. I gotcha.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, they call it shrimp scumpy anyways. It's not shrimp scampi. It's shrimp scumpy.
Oh, right. Yes. Well, that makes sense.
Well, if you ever had shrimp scampi, you probably like it. But if you ever had shrimp scumpy, you will love it.
I don't eat seafood. Frankly, it frightens me. I don't want any mercury. Scumpy, you got anything what?
Oh, no, go ahead.
I was just going to ask you if you have anything to plug. You've got, I know you've got a show. Did that show happen already, the one in Concord, coming up?
No, that's June 15th.
Okay.
At Pitt Road, June 15th. It's the end of motorcycle weekend. It's right on Loudon Road. It's in Concord, but it's on Loudon Road.
Yep.
Yeah, it should be great. It should be awesome.
Very nice. DEF CON, yes. All right. And what about the acting?
Acting, I get a couple of scripts, but they're not calling me back on them yet because they got too many things going on.
Yeah.
Narrow Street Films.
Yeah.
They have a lot of things going on. And, you know, they're trying to push stuff. And, you know, they're going to, like, the Cannes, all the film festivals. Try, like, Chance, the movie Chance I was in. Dinner Party. You know, they're trying to push those. And if you get so many views, and then they put it on Amazon Prime. Like my other one, which you have seen.
Yes.
Right?
The last two.
And that's a short film. But these other ones, they're full-length movies. There's another one. There's a full-length movie on there. I'm not in it, but it's called Not That Guy on Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
It's a great movie, and it's Narrow Street Films.
Okay.
You know, Terry Trainor.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a great movie. Me and my wife watched it. Great movie.
Oh.
You can get it on Amazon Prime. It's called Not That Guy.
Very good. Very good. All right. Has Peter White watched the last two yet? Do you know?
No, I don't think so. You know, I'm supposed to be on there tomorrow morning. I'm kind of like, I don't know. Am I going or am I not? What do you think, Matt?
Really? You're on the fence about going to the morning show? Why?
I don't know. Well, I got to cover for a guy on vacation, so I have to be. If I can do it, but I have to go right from there. I get up at 6,
yeah.
Go there, and then go right to work. At like 9:30, 10 o'clock, I got to be there.
Oh.
So, do I want to sleep in and go in at 10, or do I want to go down there, get up at 6, go there, and then, you know what I mean?
Right, right, yes.
I might want those extra 2 hours sleep. I don't know.
You might. Well, you know, it's not like you get anything for doing the show.
No, and you know what? I love you.
We love you, Scumpy.
You went to the bookery. You went to the bookery.
Yes.
You came and saw me.
Yes.
That's why we love you, Matt Connerton.
Thank you. Yes.
You do. You show up and you back your friends.
Yes. I actually want that to.
I love it.
I want that to be my epitaph on my tombstone when I'm not that I plan to die. I like to think I'm going to live forever like the kids from Fame. But I'd like that to be on my tombstone. Matt Connerton, he went to stuff and backed his friends.
Yeah, he's on DEF CON in 1999.
I'm
looking. Yeah, but no, it's great. No, Matt, you do.
Well, it's the least
you
I
went,
can
you
do.
You went to the bookery with Rob Azevedo, and that's awesome.
Jenny in the Facebook live chat is saying I'm evil. I don't think so.
Oh, you're a lovely man.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that, Scumpy.
I keep supporting your show. You support my show.
Yes.
You even show up. And
I even show
up. I don't care. Peter White doesn't, but...
He does
you know,
not.
That's a kind of a thing. That's the soap opera thing. We got to keep going here.
Right. Oh, yes. Of course. Yes. Well, if there's lingering...
I can't wait.
If there's lingering resentment...
I can't wait to... Yeah, I can't wait to. He yells at me tomorrow morning.
He's
calling
gonna,
your show again.
You think he's gonna? I don't think he's gonna yell at you. I don't think he'll yell at you again. I mean, he kind of gave it. I mean, he what was that uncomfortable? Was it last week? He kind of let you have it there.
It was a little uncomfortable.
Yeah, he
but,
kind
you know,
of.
I can take it. I thought
he was going to pull out a clipboard and give you a written warning or something. Maybe a performance review.
Yeah, and I have the game for tomorrow, too. What if I give you one? I'll give you one game. Let me see if you know the answer, right?
Okay.
Who else is with you?
Nobody. I'm all by myself.
You're all alone?
All alone. Just me and Robert
okay,
Mueller.
Okay, you tell me what came out first, okay?
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Do you have...
Okay, no. Chutes and Ladders.
Uh-huh.
Or Candyland. What game came out first?
Candyland.
Is it Candyland?
I'm saying Candyland. That is my official answer.
You are wrong.
Oh, Chutes
no. Chutes and Ladders was 1943 and Candyland was 1949.
No.
Jesus, buddy.
Wow. Well, that'll be exciting tomorrow morning on the morning show. You're not going to recycle that question, are you? Because I don't know if Peter's going to like you recycling a question you already used on this show.
What?
He might get upset.
I don't know. He's probably listening anyway. So.
He probably is.
He'll probably be playing. He goes, oh, you're drunk again. And I have had a few beers. You know what I do? I sit in my car.
Mm-hmm.
I listen to the...
You don't drink and drive, do you?
Repeat. No. Oh. I sit in my driveway.
Oh.
I put the thing on. I have a couple of beers, and
yeah.
I call you. Because well, we're not practicing tonight, so...
Oh, okay. So you sit in your driveway and you drink?
I sit in my driveway, drink, and I listen to the repeat of the Peter White, and I listen to you.
Wow. Now, I didn't think that you were inebriated at all. When you called initially, I thought you sounded actually very clear and coherent.
No, I am very coherent. I have to go in, actually, and I'm going to make dinner for the wife. She'll be home about 5:30, 5:45.
There you go.
And I'm going to go in and make some dinner.
All right.
And I have some real nice stuff to make.
Well, very good. Very good. You got to make her
being a chef like I am, I'll make some.
Make
very,
her a little
nice.
A little shrimp scumpy, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, a little shrimp scumpy. Yeah.
All right. Well, all right, Scumpy. Well, thank you for the call, my friend, and look forward to hearing you on the morning show tomorrow.
All right, Matt.
All right, brother. Take care.
Always a pleasure.
All right, man. Have a good night.
Yeah.
All right. Bye-bye. Bye. All right, the great Jeff Scumpy Lorenz of the band Def Con. Let's see. Oh, hello to Bill Berry in the Facebook live chat. Jenny says they have radio online. That's true, Scumpy. You can listen inside. Oh, Alderman Bill Berry in the Facebook live chat says hello, Matt. Hello, Bill Berry. All right, so we're going to get back to this Mueller's statement where it's almost the top of the hour, but I'll hold off on the break until we get through this part. Let's see, here we go.
The special counsel's office is part of the Department of Justice, and by regulation, it was bound by that department policy. Charging the president with a crime was therefore not an option we could consider. The department's written opinion explaining the policy makes several important points that further informed our handling of the obstruction investigation. Those points are summarized in our report, and I will describe two of them for you. First, the opinion explicitly permits the investigation of a sitting president because it is important to preserve evidence while memories are fresh and documents available.
All right, we're going to pause that for a moment because we do have another call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, Matt, it's Scumpy again. Hey,
Scumpy, how are you? What's that? Oh, you want me to play Deuce?
Deuce.
All right.
No, we always do the kiss thing.
Yeah.
Deuce from the live one.
All right, I'll play it when I'm going to take the break in a few minutes, and I'll play it for you.
All right, thank you.
All right, you got it, brother. All right, bye-bye. Bye-bye. All right, Scumpy wants to hear Deuce by Kiss, so we'll play that. That'll be one of my songs during the break. Kiss is my favorite band, so.
Among other things, that evidence could be used if there were co-conspirators who could be charged now. And second, the opinion says that the Constitution requires a process other than the criminal justice system to formally accuse a sitting president of wrongdoing. And beyond department policy, we were guided by principles of fairness. It would be unfair to potentially accuse somebody of a crime when there can be no court resolution of the actual charge. So that was Justice Department policy. Those were the principles under which we operated. And from them, we concluded that we would not reach a determination one way or the other about whether the president committed a crime. That is the office's final position, and we will not comment on any other conclusions or hypotheticals about the president. We conducted an independent criminal investigation and reported the results to the Attorney General, as required by regulations.
Orangey.
The Attorney General then concluded that it was appropriate to provide our report to Congress and to the American people. At one point in time, I requested that certain portions of the report be released. The Attorney General preferred to make the entire report public all at once, and we appreciate that the Attorney General made the report largely public, and I certainly do not question the Attorney General's good faith in that decision. Now, I hope and expect this to be the only time that I will speak to you in this manner. I am making that decision myself. No one has told me whether I can or should testify or speak further about this matter. There has been discussion about an appearance before Congress. Any testimony from this office would not go beyond our report. It contains our findings and analysis and the reasons for the decisions we made. We chose those words carefully, and the work speaks for itself. And the report is my testimony. I would not provide information beyond that which is already public in any appearance before Congress. In addition, access to our underlying work product is being decided in a process that does not involve our office. So beyond what I have said here today and what is contained in our written work, I do not believe it is appropriate for me to speak further about the investigation or to comment on the actions of the Justice Department or Congress. And it's for that reason I will not be taking questions today as well. Now, before I step away, I want to thank the attorneys, the FBI agents, the analysts, the professional staff who helped us conduct this investigation in a fair and independent manner. These individuals, who spent nearly 2 years with the special counsel's office, were of the highest integrity. And I will close by reiterating the central allegation of our indictments, that there were multiple systematic efforts to interfere in our election. And that allegation deserves the attention of every American. Thank you. Thank you for being here today.
Sir, if you're subpoenaed, do you
have
no question.
So just so in case you couldn't hear it, so someone asked him, you know, as he's getting ready to leave, someone yelled out, you know, sir, if you are subpoenaed, do you intend to testify before Congress? Because that's been a topic of discussion And he said no questions, and he leaves. So that's it. That was Robert Mueller's statement. Let's take a break. We will play Scumpy's request from Kiss Alive, the original live version of Deuce. And I've got something else I'm going to play for you as well. And I usually play a couple things. And a little political song parody for after that. And then we'll come back. You're listening to Matt Connerton Unleashed. We are live on WMNH 95.3. Don't go anywhere.
You wanted the best and you got it. The hottest band in the land. Kiss!
Thank you, Your Majesty. Is it true that you threw a tiny baby temper tantrum and stormed out of your infrastructure meeting after learning that Nancy Pelosi accused you of being, quote, engaged in a cover-up?
I don't do cover-ups. This meeting was set up a number of days ago at 11 o'clock. All of a sudden, I hear last night they're going to have a meeting right before this meeting to talk about the I-word.
The what?
The I-word.
Impotent?
The I-word.
Irrational?
The I-word.
Idris Elba?
The I-word.
Oh! Impeachment.
Can you imagine?
Well,
the whole thing with Russia was a hoax. And I will tell you, my lawyers say, you don't have to do this. You can use presidential privilege. You don't have to let your lawyers and all of your staff testify. Would you recommend it? Well, you can be transparent or you can be tight.
Sweetie, you seem riled up. Would you like a hard candy or maybe a ventilator?
These people were out to get us.
Well, if I may, Mr. President.
Some days, Democrats can be a pain trying to circumvent. It's hard to be the fake president. What crazy sounds you make. Is it a substance that you're sniffing? Or could it just be a sinus thing? Life just ain't rosy. Nancy Pelosi's creeping on your TV, acting shady. Try to drop Mueller. Thought this was over, but she's got your number now, and you feel under attack. Just keep breathing and breathing and breathing and breathing. You know they might impeach. Keep on breathing. Just keep wheezing, seething, panting, grimacing. Your teeth are falling out. Your teeth in
presidential privilege.
You clown and mess around, joking about subpoenas they give, invoking so much executive privilege. But now things got you down. Thought that your Fox friends would never cheat. Why they all crushing on Mayor Pete?
Ooh, girl.
They just dissed Donald. Now he's dissed Ronald. He's breathing like my old man's carburetor. Ew. He cries no fair and claims he's transparent. I guess you could say he's right, cause we see through him every time.
Madam Speaker, dozens of House Democrats, along with multiple legal experts and my Aunt Linda, have found clear grounds for impeachment. Where do you stand?
I don't think we should impeach a president for political reasons.
How about just for fun?
We have to see what the facts are. I mean, this is not a day at the beach. Let's hope that a level of maturity here will set in, because the American people expect results.
Just impeach him, impeach him, impeach him, impeach him.
Well, let me say.
Excuse me. They say the only way you can reach him is impeach him, impeach him, impeach him. But you know it's what they want. Just impeach him.
Sir, you tweeted a video of Speaker Pelosi, which was clearly doctored to make her appear drunk or impaired. Isn't that a cheap shot?
What they've done is abuse. The President of the United States engaged in a cover. Oh, let's call Russia. Maybe they get it's a hoax.
Just keep tweeting, retweeting, misleading, and cheating. Gross. I hear a lot of phlegm when he's breathing. Just impeach him, impeach him, impeach him, but I'm tired of hearing them say impeach him.
Just do it already. Let's go get a drink.
With your skies falling, just keep so falling. You know what's going on with his breathing. What's we been huffing? Is she just loving?
God bless the United States.
Girl.
Lord, we thank you for this day and please protect us from anything that might lead or affect us astray. Kids, make sure you read your Bibles, it's the best word. You can't be watching nothing with the S word, okay? You know it breaks my heart. Our culture is a course and Clinton was the start. And 8 years more debt. We need to get back to the tenets of small government. That's why I came to cheer and watch. A statist who likes to grab crotch. So give me more disclosure of entitlement proposals. I used to say we can't afford. Tax my trade and close the border. Give crude language the exposure that up till now I abhorred. While I'm not a total poser, you could say I'm getting closer.
you. Look at all you people out here nodding, while soon there's gonna be a lot of bombings. We grieve. Trump, that guy just gives the pot a stirring motion. I haven't seen such terrible emotions since New Year's Eve. You know it breaks my heart, the wars are never ending, George Bush was the start, and Don Trump, Mike Pence, we need to stop the droning, it's just common sense. Those are things I'll protest and scream, unless you know it hurts my team. So hand me a pink poster, because now I'm an opposer of the bombings and the wars that for 8 years I glossed over. My memory is as selective as Meryl Streep's, I suppose. Past that stuff we brought from Boulder, you could say I'm getting closer. You could say we're getting closer. You could say we're getting closer.
I mean, it's not funny. It's nothing.
Hey everybody, welcome back. It's Matt Connerton Unleashed. Well, in hour number two here on WMNH 95.3 in downtown Manchester. Also on Comcast 97 in Manchester, streaming at WMNHradio.org and on the Facebook and the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. Let's see. Oh, I see Candace Johnson in there. Haven't seen Candace for a while. She says, Matt, I'm not ignoring you, but I can't hardly ever hear you, and now feed is coming and going. I don't know, ? I don't know. It looks like everything's working here. I don't know, Candace. Well, if you can't listen live, I mean, we do archive all the shows at WMNHradio.org. But, oh, and hello to Tony Petrello, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. So, let's see. Let's do this. I don't want to necessarily spend the entire show on Mueller, but it is kind of a big deal. We so rare, you know, there's a lot of Americans who, of course, have never even heard the voice of Robert Mueller until today. You know, he really didn't talk at all during the Russia probe, or the Mueller probe, whatever you want to call it. But actually, we have a call. Maybe this is it. Maybe this is Robert Mueller. I keep hoping he'll call the show now that he's got nothing else to do. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
This is EZG.
EZG, you, sir, are clearly not Robert Mueller.
No, I'm not. Hey, I heard the Scubby phone call. Boy, he really loves your show.
He does love my show. Sometimes, EZG.
I love your show, too, but guess what? I love all the shows.
Well, what are you implying? Are you implying that Scumpy doesn't love all the shows? Don't you think he...
Yeah, I think he's just trying to make good radio. He'll be there tomorrow morning. Maybe I'll go, maybe I won't.
I'm sure he will be, but he did kind of...
I heard the replay last week about the show when he was on there. That was a good radio. I even told Peter like that. That was a good forth and back and back and forth. Oh, my God.
You kidding? Of course I heard it. I was riveted.
That was the funniest thing when he said, you know... What do you expect something from the show? You know, nobody has their own theme music, and then they punch in Pauly C, the place.
Yes. You even have your own.
Yeah, speaking about Pauly C, shout out. I saw him on Elm Street for like 10 seconds, and he was on a phone call. He goes, hey, EZG. So I said, hi.
Oh, you actually
said
hello to
Bill Burke.
To who?
I bumped into him today. I said, what's your name? I said, Bill Burke. I said, hey, you're the guy that called me out when I was on the way to the Red Barn. He said, yeah, I was.
Wow. Well, look
at
you.
Shout out to Bill Burt.
Bill Burt.
Yeah, in the meantime, I think I'm going to take advantage of the Peter White's request to be in a bubble, because I seem to collect all these health problems that I don't want. And I went to the doctors today and said, boy, I'm not feeling well. I've had all this trouble with my feet.
Uh-huh.
And the doctor said, well, you have another round of cellulitis.
Right. Yeah, I looked it up.
So it just happened in April. It's like, oh, it's a friend that you just can't seem to get rid of.
Hey, you're not
so
the only
one. Some medication for it, and they gave me some the usual drill. You got to keep your feet elevated, try to stay off your feet.
You know, you're not the only
pain
one.
Pain medication too. I can take that three times a day because I've just been so much pain lately. It's awful.
You're not the only one, EZG, with health problems around here. There's a couple other people. Virtual John Hopwood. He's got his issues.
And my bowels.
Who doesn't have?
You can
issues?
See it on the.
and then there's Peter White.
I definitely. I have herpes.
So it's all going around.
Yeah, yeah, true. Oh my God, you're right. That's even worse than anything I've got. That's for sure.
I know. Although,
I think I should take advantage of that request by Peter White. So if Peter White's listening there.
So you're going to live in a bubble.
Making that bubble.
You're going to be our very own bubble boy.
Yeah. All right. Well, have a great rest of your show, Matt. You're the best.
Well, thank you, EZG. All right. I am the best. Can you even believe it? Oh, geez, I don't have the air horn ready. That deserves an air horn. But I was doing something else. Oh, boy, we might have to have a delayed air horn. I mean, he said I'm the best. There we go. There. All right. Let's see. 603-250-6007 is the number to call. If you would like to also call and tell me I'm the best. It's a big responsibility being the best. But I believe, you know, I have broad shoulders. I think I can handle it. Let's see. So this is from thehill.com. Five takeaways from Mueller's presentation today. So it says here, ooh boy, this is written with a lot of flair. Special counsel Robert Mueller sent shockwaves through Washington on Wednesday. Shockwaves! By delivering his first and possibly only public remarks on his investigation. Well, he did say that this would be his only remark. He doesn't want to. He basically said during his speech. He said, we won't speak of this again. And he does not want to testify before Congress and et cetera. So during a brief 9-minute appearance, Mueller made clear that he did not plan on speaking further about his 2-year-long investigation and gave fuel to pro-impeachment Democrats pressing their leadership to take action. Here are the five takeaways. Number one, Mueller gives pro-impeachment Dems an argument, and this circles back to what Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple, what he was referring to when he called earlier. Mueller said that if his office, quote, had confidence that the president clearly did not commit a crime, we would have said so, unquote. And, you know, like I said earlier, Bill Bard initially said when he kind of summarized everything for everybody, you know, the report does not exonerate the president. Mueller kind of put a finer point on it. Not only does it not exonerate him, but we would have said if we didn't think he committed a crime or if we had the confidence to use his exact words that the president did not commit a crime, we would have said so. So that's kind of damning. And as Fred said, you know, he's not allowed to say we think he should be prosecuted because, as Mueller himself reminds everyone during the statement, you cannot indict a sitting president as per the Justice Department policy. It's literally on their website. It's like when you, when you go and you read the terms of service for a product or something, you know, it's right there. Let's see. He also said that the Department of Justice guidance prohibited his office from bringing charges against the president. And that same guidance states, quote, that the Constitution requires a process other than the criminal justice system to formally accuse a sitting president of wrongdoing, unquote. And that's the other thing that Fred was talking about when he called in. What Mueller was saying is, look, here's the process. Congress, you have to do something. You know, because first he says, if we had confidence that the president clearly did not commit a crime, we would have said so. Right? And then he says, the Constitution requires a process other than the criminal justice system to formally accuse a sitting president of wrongdoing. In other words, you know, this, you got to impeach him. If you want to do something, this is what you do. I mean, you know, he's almost begging them, you know, you have to begin impeachment proceedings. Now, and we'll get to the rest of the other four takeaways in a second, but what will be interesting to see is how does this affect Nancy Pelosi's position on this? Pelosi has been saying up to now, no, we're not going to go forward with impeachment. Nadler, meanwhile, Gerald Nadler keeps saying, yeah, we should. He even made a statement today. I don't know if we'll get to that because it's already almost 5:30, but on days like today, we just don't have enough time for everything. Pelosi has been saying no, and, you know, they don't have the risk, and I think, and, you know, Nancy Pelosi, whether you like her or not, whether you agree with her or not, you know, she's no dummy. She's not new at this. She knows you can begin an impeachment in the House, but it's the Senate that ultimately has to try and either convict or acquit the president. And it's a Republican-controlled Senate. So what happens if the House moves to impeach and the Senate does their trial and they acquit the president? And then that's it. Does that not just make Trump, does that not just put him in an even stronger position going into 2020? Does that not vindicate him in the eyes of many? So unless, now I think this is extraordinarily unlikely. Unless all these Republican senators, well, wouldn't take all of them. Some of these Republican senators start going, you know, he really is, in many ways, just an albatross. We can dump him right now and have President Pence. We can impeach and remove, convict and remove him. We can have President Pence and then have President Pence running for re-election in 2020. It's a possibility. I don't see it happening because they're so terrified of the base. You know, unless your name is Justin Amash, you're terrified of the Republican base. Look, I mean, Trump, he's got a 90% approval rating among Republicans. So if you're a Republican who holds office, hey, no wonder you don't criticize him on anything. No wonder you don't stand up to him on anything. For example, and we were talking with when Scumpy called earlier, we were talking about the farmers and how Trump's trade war is destroying the farming sector. You know, but I always said, you know, I've always said the Republican Party was the party of free trade and free market economics. And then Trump came along and said, no, we're not the party of free trade anymore. We're protectionists now. And then the entire Republican Party just shrugged and said, okay, we're protectionists now. So it's hard to imagine. I mean, you know, Mitch McConnell would have to be tempted, though. You know, it would cross his mind if it came to it. Oh, we can actually get rid of this guy. We can get rid of this guy. Oh. It has to cross his mind. It has to have crossed his mind. He'll never admit it. But then, if you're a Democrat, you have to ask yourself this. And this is something that I've always kind of, it surprises me sometimes, the enthusiasm among Democrats for getting rid of Trump, because it's like, or let me put it this way, getting rid of him other than beating him in 2020. Because, you know, weigh that against, yeah, maybe you'd love to get rid of him, and that would be a big political victory to get rid of him, certainly. I mean, that's undeniable. But where do you end up on the other side? You end up with President Pence. Is that better? I mean, yeah, I'm an independent. I can't speak for y'all on the left, but I'll tell you this. I don't know. On the one hand, I think President, I think Mike Pence You know, he's far more well-spoken. He can speak English coherently. I mean, Trump sometimes, I mean, he makes Sarah Palin sound like a master wordsmith. Pence, I think, is just a much more competent individual. But, wow. I mean, he's pretty right-wing. Very conservative. And I think he has certain conservative impulses that I don't think Trump necessarily has. Hear me out. Some of you are probably saying, no, BS. But listen, I don't think Mike Pence, I don't know what his position on criminal justice reform is, but if I were a betting man, Mike Pence would not have signed criminal justice reform into law. Something that I've given Trump great credit for, by the way, and Jared Kushner. And Van Jones, who was a big proponent of it, and was very active in getting that done, he gave, I mean, I don't think he'll, probably the only nice thing he'll ever say about Trump or Jared Kushner, but he gave them great credit for getting that done. The First Step Act, it's only a first step. We need to see more. But would Pence have done that? I don't think so. I don't know. To be fair, I don't know. I don't know his position on that specifically. But if I were a betting man, I'd say no. Trump has expressed an openness to doing something about cannabis federally, moving it off of Schedule 1 or doing something bigger, you know, doing a federal decriminalization of cannabis. I mean, Trump says a lot of things he's open to and then doesn't follow through, so take it for what it's worth. You know, like I said to Scumpy earlier, he said he was going to take us out of Syria. We're still there. He said we were going to draw down in Afghanistan. We're still there. So I don't know, but I can't imagine Pence even saying that he would be open to that. I'm sure Pence is very pro drug war. I'm sure of that. So yeah, you can look, I don't mean to rain on anyone's parade. And I know some people are very excited after Mueller's statement today because this is helpful. This does bolster the pro-impeachment argument. And again, it really does come down to these two very specific statements, which now I've lost. Oh, these two very specific statements. When Mueller said they, quote, had confidence that the president clearly did not, if they had confidence the president did not commit a crime, they would have said so, and that the Constitution requires a process other than the criminal justice system to formally accuse a sitting president of wrongdoing. So that's score one for the pro-impeachment crowd. Score one for Nadler. Score one for all of you who would love that. I'd like to see it just because I think it'd be fascinating as a political junkie. I, you know, that would just be so interesting to see that play out. But I feel like nobody ever stops to think, where do you end up on the other side? And maybe that's part of Nancy Pelosi's calculation as well, by the way. Where do you end up on the other side? Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, Matt, this is Tony Petrello. How you doing?
Hey, Tony. Good. How are you?
Good. I just want to call and introduce myself and tell you that I love your show and you are the best. And I try to catch it every day, man.
Well, thank you.
Great job.
Well, thanks, Tony. You've called before, though, haven't you?
I have not called before, nope. I mean, I'm either in the show, in the room, or...
oh, yeah, I see you in the... I see you in the Facebook live chat. That's probably why I thought that.
Right. Maybe someday I'll pop in some afternoon and
I would love
it. We can agree to disagree.
I would love it.
So maybe someday I'll pop in and we'll agree to disagree.
I would love it, Tony. You have an open invitation. No, that'd be
great.
You're
awesome. Hey, Matt, keep up the good work.
All right. Thanks, Tony. I appreciate it.
Okay. I'll be in touch, buddy.
All right. Cool. Thank you.
All right. Okay.
All right.
Adios.
All right. Bye-bye. All right, Tony Petrello. Yeah, I see Tony in the Facebook live chat all the time. There's another gentleman named Tony who has called before, but apparently it's not the same. All this time, I assumed it was the same Tony. I don't know why I would assume that. Tony's a fairly common name, but Tony wants to come in and agree to disagree with me, which is cool. I like talking to people with whom I disagree. I think it's a lot more interesting than sitting around just agreeing with people. There's a lot of that in media, you know, whether it's MSNBC on the left or Fox on the right. You know, you see a lot of these shows where people are just sitting around agreeing on everything and reinforcing each other's opinions. I think that gets a little tiresome. So, Tony, I would love it. Pop in anytime. Let's see. We should. Oh, wow, boy. Got a bunch of activity in the Facebook live chat. Hello to Chris Rose, who joins us. Rhonda is in there. Hello, Rhonda. Jackie Brown, better known as G-Girl. Hello. Let's see. Fred says, you mean if they prove that Trump cheated, was a tax fraud, insurance fraud, bank fraud, having been a supporter, won't stick like glue. Also, the Senate got 87 votes for this thing. That says we did something right. Trump couldn't veto it. For what? I'm confused, Fred. Clarify that if you could. I'm not sure. I'm not sure what that means. And Fred says, who starts your car? Oh, what do you mean, Fred? All right, let's see. Back to the five takeaways here, because we are, oh wow, it's getting late. It's already after 5:30. Today's flown by. Oh, I know. Fred's referring to the First Step Act, I think, because it got 87 votes in the, yep, First Step, yeah. So in other words, Trump couldn't veto it, because, you know, they would have had enough votes to override the veto anyway. But I don't think, Fred, I don't think Trump would have vetoed it anyway, even if they didn't have the votes to override, because this was something Jared Kushner, was working on directly with Van Jones. So if I'm understanding your point correctly, I don't think Trump would have, and now Trump's actually using that, by the way. See, Trump is now using that to make a case against Biden, because it was yesterday. Because it's already Trump versus Biden. I mean, obviously, we have a long way to go till the Democrats have a nominee, and a lot could change and shift. But at the moment, both Trump and Biden appear to be running a general election campaign, and Trump is already saying, look, look what I've done for criminal justice reform. I signed the First Step Act. Biden backed that, voted for that 1994 crime bill. Not that everything in the crime bill was bad, but some of the things in the crime bill were bad. And, you know, I mean, for one thing, I'm someone who's very anti-drug war. So I'm not a big fan of, you know, mandatory minimums, for example, like the three strikes laws and in California and things like that, where, because then you have a situation where somebody might have gone away a couple of times, maybe a violent criminal, and then on their third strike, they get caught with some cannabis, and, oh, that's illegal. You're off to prison for the rest of your life. And that kind of thing actually happened. You know, anyway, so the point being, Trump is now able to use signing the First Step Act to his advantage, because it's a way for him to say, look, Biden, he said something about, I don't remember exactly what he said, and I don't have it right in front of me, but something about Biden increased incarceration for African Americans in this country, and I'm decreasing it. Now, there's a problem with saying it that way, though. Then Trump gets himself into trouble because he's so stunningly inarticulate. Because then it sounds like he's saying that it, you know, it's only blacks who commit crime. So if you do criminal justice reform, that's who it impacts, is African Americans. It gets a little tricky. He trips himself up. But hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, Matt, Mike Doyle calling.
Mike Doyle, how are you? Haven't heard from
good,
you in a while.
Got...
Good, good. What's happening?
Your boy Fred there tripped over himself with a case of Trump disorder syndrome, saying that he wouldn't veto it know, that bill. He couldn't wait for that bill to get to his desk. That was, and as you just noted, he's using it as an accomplishment, which I guess it is, right? It is an accomplishment. It's
You
got to work with Van. You got to work with Van Jones and
right.
And Kushner, and they got something done. And you know, it's a positive thing.
I agree. And, no, I've given them great credit for that. Absolutely.
Yeah, and your boy Fred can't wait to say, oh, he couldn't have vetoed it anyways, like he was going to. So that just tells you what a moonbat he is. But anyways, listen, well, not the reason for my call.
I disagree that he's a moonbat, but go ahead.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah.
Fred's my friend. But yes, go ahead,
yeah,
Mike.
No, that's good. Listen, just answer me this one question. Here's the only question I have. I haven't heard it on any station. I tried to flip, and I just can't because nobody talks about it. What would you be impeaching Donald Trump for? What would be the impeachment offense?
Oh, it'd be obstruction of justice.
Obstruction of justice, meaning the Mueller report, they just spent how many guys, lawyers they have that hated Donald Trump and had every possible thing they could have at their fingertips, emails, subpoenas, testimony, video, and they found nothing. But still, they just want to run with this narrative of obstruction of justice.
Well, have you read the report, Mike? I mean, there's, depending on whose count you want to go by, there's 9, 10, or 11 different instances where Trump attempted to obstruct. I think the most glaring one being when he told Don McGahn, hey, go fire Mueller. And then when McGahn right. wouldn't do it, he said, hey, I need you to falsify a document saying that that conversation never happened, that I never told you to fire Mueller. I mean, that's a pretty clear obstruction, isn't it? Unless you think McGahn is lying.
He could tell McGahn to go fire Mueller. That's not a crime.
That's obstruction of justice.
To tell McGahn to go fire somebody that he has the right to fire, he's the boss. McGahn works for him. And Mueller works for the Justice Department, who the president, right? I mean, there's no rule that says, you know, I don't like him, I want him fired. Appoint somebody else.
I think that's technically true, but...
You guys just make it up as you go along here. There's no rule that says you can't do that. There's no rule that says if somebody comes to you and says, I have information on your opponent, where's the law that says you can't say, all right, I'll listen?
Yeah, but
can't you listen to that?
We're talking about an ongoing criminal investigation. If you do something to actively interfere in a criminal investigation, that's obstruction of justice. It doesn't matter who's boss or anything. When it's in that realm, when it's a criminal an ongoing criminal investigation, you can't just do that with the express purpose of impeding or ending the investigation. That's obstruction. That's illegal.
Oh, right. But
in any context.
Maybe you're saying this is taking just a little bit too long. You don't think almost 2 years to come up with nothing was a little bit overburdened there, a little silly.
Come up with nothing. There's something like 40. What was it? 40 different indictments from this investigation. That's not nothing.
All people in the past, nothing to do with Trump, as far as you know, he was in business with somebody who didn't pay their taxes or something. You know, Russian spies who they caught. I don't know. It's just tough to listen to you guys. You just don't want to see the facts. You still don't want to talk about Strzok. You still don't want to talk about the falsifying of how this whole thing started. And now Nancy Pelosi is the only smart one because she knows they have nothing to go at an impeachment for. And to go at the Republican Senate, who has the majority and is easily going to turn it down and shoot it down, Why would she enter that fray? Why would she say, I'll go in blind, I'll take my chances? She has to go to these people in the Senate and say, hey, we caught him doing this. He broke the law. He needs to be impeached.
Well, it's
she doesn't have anything. She's the only smart one. The other ones are like Fred. They all have Trump disorder where they just can't stand the guy. And they don't want to open their eyes to what good he's done for this country.
I would suggest reading the report, Mike. I think there's plenty, but Pelosi knows she can't. You did read it?
I read the whole thing, my friend.
Oh, you did? Okay. Well,
I went up to Maine. I went to Bar Harbor, and I had the transcript.
Yeah.
I was sitting on the beach, and I read the whole thing.
All right. Well, so you're fine. You're fine with all of Trump's nothing in there bothered you, huh?
Well, he's the president of the country. He's trying to run the country and put it back on its feet here. Did he say something wrong? Did he tweak something the wrong way? I mean, come on. You got to give the guy a little room to work. I'm not saying break the law, but ask people for different advice. That's wrong. Somebody from Russia wants to give you information about your opponent. Why can't you listen to that? Explain that to me.
Oh, Mike,
The Democrats have been talking about the Trump meeting in the Trump Towers with the Russians for how long now?
Three years. Mike, I don't care about that part. As far as I'm concerned, the report absolves him on collusion. And I said all along, I didn't think Trump colluded anyway, because I didn't think Trump ever wanted to be president.
Yeah. But, it's funny thing, just ask this question sometimes. Just what if it was all made up? And this Russia thing shouldn't have started from the beginning, because Peter Strzok was trying to prove to his girlfriend that he had a plan B. And I'm going to start a warrant. And just, I don't know, nobody wants to, you don't want to do the investigative work on that end, because it's too revealing.
But well, it was Rosenstein who ordered the investigation.
I understand what they're doing now. They're timing, so this whole thing with the Strzok and all that, it's going to come out right before the election. And then he's going to look like a hero. I can see that coming a mile away.
Well,
Whether you like him or not, I can just see him, you can see them timing that. They got through this little barricade of this, all these lawyers against them. Think how many people hated them on that committee they chose. They had somebody from Hillary's past, a lawyer from Hillary on that committee, and they couldn't come up with anything. Come on. Anyways, good show as usual. It stimulates people like me to call, and that's a good thing, man.
No, I appreciate the call, Mike. I always appreciate the call. Thank you.
All right, see ya.
All right, bye-bye. All right, that was Mike Doyle. Fred was typing in the Facebook live chat. I wasn't ignoring you, Fred. I was just kind of, I figured we'll get to it after. So Fred put this, I don't know where this is. Tell me where this is from, Fred. Fred put a question. Can President Donald Trump fire Special Counsel Robert Mueller? Answer, not directly. Only the public attorney general who appointed Mueller. Excuse me. I can fire him, and only for cause, but Trump could fire the DAG, the deputy attorney general, or order the special counsel regulations repealed and fire Mueller himself. Let's see. Fred said, did Manafort give polling data to the Russians? Yes, Manafort himself was colluding with the Russians. We found that out from Manafort's own lawyers when they released that redacted document that turned out to be pretty easy to unredact with a couple of keystrokes on your computer. Fred says, how many open investigations, Mike? Yes, there are many open investigations ongoing. This is certainly not the end of the road. Let's see. Fred said, this is referring to, I think, my comment about the report effectively absolving Trump on collusion. Fred says, no, it didn't absolve him. They couldn't get enough to charge them because they deleted their emails and use encrypted. Yeah, I don't know. Like I said, I don't care about the collusion part personally. I never really have because I just, you know, I think that I certainly think that Don Jr. and others were. I mean, we all know about the Trump Tower meeting and the story. The stories around that kept changing. And when people keep changing their stories, it's usually because they're trying to hide something, because there's no other reason you would keep changing your story. But, you know, like I said, I mean, I don't think Trump himself, I don't think Trump himself wanted to be president. I certainly don't think he would have wanted to be president if he could have foreseen any of this. That's for sure. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, you know what was the most disturbing thing about that call?
What?
Mike Doyle on the beach. Hey, vey. God. Bye.
Bye. Well, that's not very nice. Oh. All right. I have nothing to add to that. I like Mike. And I don't like the only thing I don't like name calling. So when Mike called Fred a moonbat, I don't like that. Fred is not a moonbat. Fred is an accomplished journalist and he's my friend. So that type of thing makes me uncomfortable. Let's see. Although I'm sure I've called all kinds of people all kinds of names, so maybe I shouldn't talk. What time is it? Oh, wow, we're almost out of time. I want to get through the rest of these takeaways just really, really quickly. Okay. We're actually still on the first one. So Mueller gives pro-impeachment Dems an argument. Let's see. So Senator Cory Booker, Democrat of New Jersey and presidential candidate, who had previously not called for Trump's impeachment. This is what he tweeted today after Mueller's statement. Robert Mueller's statement makes it clear Congress has a legal and moral obligation to begin impeachment proceedings immediately. Other Democrats were more cautious. Speaker Nancy Pelosi, who has sought to keep a lid on impeachment talk, said Congress would, quote, continue to investigate and legislate to protect our elections and secure our democracy, unquote, in a statement that didn't mention impeachment. If that was after Mueller's statement, then I guess that answers my question earlier when I said it'll be interesting to see if this changes Pelosi's mind at all. Other key lawmakers also avoided the word impeachment, even as they vowed to take action. So I'm going to kind of skip down because I want to get through the other four of these, even if we just have to blast through them. Okay, number two, this is five takeaways from Mueller's statement today. This is from TheHill.com. GOP says case closed. It says, while Democrats want to impeach Trump, while they have some new talking points, Republicans seized on Mueller's statements as bolstering their own familiar argument that it's time to move on. Doug Collins of Georgia, representative, the top Republican on the House Judiciary Committee, said in a statement, quote, special counsel Robert Mueller confirmed today what we knew months ago when his report was released. There was no collusion and no obstruction. Relitigating the 2016 election and reinvestigating the special counsel's findings will only further divide our country, unquote. Well, that's not what Mueller said today, but okay. Senate Judiciary Committee Chairman Lindsey Graham made similar remarks in a statement today, saying the case is over. Republicans have been saying this ever since Barr first released his memo summarizing the Mueller report, and nothing the special counsel said today is going to change that argument. While Mueller once again made it clear that he was not exonerating Trump, it'll be up to Democrats to take any next steps. Polls have shown that many Americans are ready to move on from Mueller, and that's one reason Pelosi has tread so cautiously on the impeachment issue. While Mueller gave pro-impeachment Democrats some new ammunition, he didn't say anything that will force Republicans to change their game plan. Well, like I said, I just think Pelosi thinks the risk is too high. Let's see. Number three, Mueller doesn't want to testify. We kind of knew that already. There were definitely some signals that Mueller did not want to have to do that. We're going to kind of skip that one. Next one, Mueller seeks to quash differences with Barr. You know, it's been reputed that they were very good friends, but this whole thing may have caused a bit of a rift. But it says here, in a March 27 letter revealed last month, Mueller objected to Attorney General William Barr's memo on his report, arguing it failed to capture the context, nature, and substance of his investigation. He also pushed Barr, a longtime friend, to immediately release more on the report, something Barr declined to do. But today, Mueller did not offer criticism of Barr, nor would I have expected him to, by the way, saying he didn't question his good faith decision in waiting to release a redacted version of the special counsel's full report. Mueller said, quote, we appreciate that the attorney general made the report largely public. I do not question the attorney general's good faith in that decision, unquote. All right. There's a little bit more there, but let's get to number five before we have to wrap up. Mueller puts emphasis on Russian meddling. Now, this part I found particularly interesting because while I feel, and I think Fred disagrees with me somewhat, but on this particular point, but while I feel, I mean, as far as the collusion part of it, I'm over it. But, and I just want to be clear, by the way, I don't want to be misunderstood on this. That's not the same as saying the Russians didn't meddle. We know the Russians meddled. Everybody in government knows the Russians meddled except Donald Trump. And even he has acknowledged it at certain points, but he doesn't like to because, you know, he doesn't want to admit that anyone's thumb was on the scale in his favor in his campaign against Hillary Clinton. Right. But, you know, and when he's standing next to Vladimir Putin, you know, oh, you know, I don't see any reason why it would have been Russian meddling. Literally everybody in government. I mean, Republican congressmen and senators say there was Russian meddling. You know, it, I mean, Trump is really on an island when it comes to that one thing. So no one really disputes that now. So, you know, accepting no collusion, which I do, that's not the, I just want to be clear, that's not the same as saying there was no Russian meddling. And Mueller did get into that. So it says here, really quickly, while much of the media coverage on Mueller's presser focused on his comments about obstruction, it was clear the former longtime chief of the FBI was focused on Moscow. Mueller said he was initially tasked with investigating the scope of Russia's meddling in the 2016 presidential election, and he outlined a pair of indictments brought forward by his office against Russian military officers who hacked Democrats ahead of the election and a Russian troll farm. Mueller said, quote, I will close by reiterating the central allegation of our indictments that there were multiple systematic efforts to interfere in our election. That allegation deserves the attention of every American, unquote. Trump has repeatedly downplayed the extent of Russia's meddling, and Senate Republicans have largely stonewalled election security bills. Senate Rules Committee Chairman Roy Blunt, Republican of Missouri, said earlier this month that he did not anticipate the Senate voting on any election security measures because Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, quote, is of the view that this debate reaches no conclusion, unquote. Well, maybe I was wrong when I said everybody. Mitch McConnell doesn't seem worried about meddling, so. Mueller's remarks could put more attention on the issue, and Democrats used his warning to back up their own calls to pass election security measures. By the way, it does occur to me it's a little bit strange that more Republicans aren't concerned about Russian meddling in our elections because they're the ones always screaming about voter fraud. I know that here in New Hampshire, I have had many conversations over the years with Republicans who really seem to believe that all these elections, there's no way any Democrat could possibly win these elections were it not for just massive voter fraud. You know, and they talk about, you know, these, you know, they'll be on election day, they'll be at one of the polls and this big bus pulls up and all these people who look like they're not quite from here get off the bus and they all go in and vote Democrat, of course. You know, even though they're not legally eligible to vote here, obviously that bus has an out-of-state license plate on it and all this. You know, I hear all these stories. And then I'm always like, okay, do you, in this era where, you know, everyone walks around with a phone that can take pictures and video, do you have some evidence of this? And they somehow never do. Every election, I hear all these stories about all over New Hampshire. There's all these people who clearly are not from here voting, and they're voting for Democrats, obviously. And but for some reason, when Republicans are witnessing all this voter fraud, they never think to snap a picture. It's very, very strange. But since Republicans are so concerned about making sure we have accurate, untampered with elections, you would think they would all be very concerned about passing some of these bills that will help to firm up our election security. But maybe it's just not a priority. Maybe it's just not a priority for Mitch McConnell, because I definitely have heard some Republicans in Congress speaking about how this does matter, and election security does matter, and the Russians did meddle, and we absolutely... So I don't want to sound like I'm painting with too broad a brush here. There are a lot of Republicans... In fairness, there are a lot of Republicans who are concerned about this and do see a need to take action. So I'm not saying everybody... I'm just picking on the Republicans who, for whatever reason, They're just like, oh, no, it's, you know, whatever. It's all good. But you know, on election day, wherever a Democrat wins, those same Republicans will be screaming about how could a Democrat possibly win an election? Clearly, there was voter fraud. No Democrat would ever win any election anywhere if there wasn't for voter fraud. There probably aren't any even real Democrats out there. They're all holograms walking around voting. Anyway, I'm being a little silly. Sometimes I get a little silly. You know, that's the end of the show. We were talking about food earlier when Scumpy called, made me hungry. Now I think my blood sugar's low. I get a little silly. I get wacky. What can I say? All right, we do have to get out of here. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you, Mike Doyle, for calling. Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple for calling. Tony Petrello for calling, apparently for the first time. Thank you. And, of course, Jeff Scumpy Lorenz. Thank you for calling. Eric Gagnon for calling. Virtual John Hopwood, who always joins me here in the studio via the computer because he's virtual. And everybody in the Facebook live chat. Busy show today. A lot of interaction. Really appreciate it. And if you missed any part of today's show, it will be up in just a few minutes at WMNHradio.org. All right, that's out of here. That's out of here. That's it for now. I'm out of here. And I'll talk at y'all a little bit later. Bye, everybody.
IPMNation.com.